basically, and they see these planets that have came in that they haven't seen before, that have been there now for just about a year. So when we talk before the show, you think that none of this stuff is really able to be accessible via view because it's being blocked or cloaked somehow with the government, correct?
Correct. They have the capabilities with lasers to cloak an object. They're like 30 years ahead of the public on where the technology is. We can, I have a video on my YouTube chart, I think it's called Bonus 2, that shows at the end of it, it shows at present what their what laboratories are doing. Well, the government's about 30 years ahead of that, and they can cloak an object.
So they're cloaking these objects with lasers and stuff, but maybe there's certain times that that technology isn't working good enough, so somebody's able to get a shot in and possibly pick something up. Do you think it's in our solar system right now?
Yes, without a doubt. Kepler's laws of planetary motion, and with our present knowledge of the model that the Chinese astronomers and the Korean and the Japanese astronomers gave us, it would take 16 years to reach the Earth if it was at the orbit of Neptune. It would take 16 years to reach us. So for it to arrive, I say, with the present effects that the Earth is having, I would say that it's no more than 5 years away, probably less than two. You know, it may even show up this next, we need to pay attention each March and April that's coming up. And because that's its exit point. And this time, the biblical record says that it's going to be the worst time in all of Earth history. So that, since it only passed close to Earth four times in its past, the scriptural accounts is alluding to a very close passing of it again. So we should see it maybe, I would think that they'd let us see it anywhere from 30 to 90 days out, but the internet will be down. People probably won't be texting each other or sending pictures. They have to have control over the people. And one of the ways they're going to do it, when you see a bail-in or a rationing of money, which is what a bail-in is, then they'll ration food and then they'll ration fuel. If you got those three rationed, you have the control over the masses. And so they're much easier to deal with because they're, you see, dependent upon the government to give them food. And that's where they'll start volunteering people with the chip system, as the Bible talks about. And some people would choose to use a credit card type chip. But the best way to handle that is to listen to the Bible. It says on a Sabbath and a Jubilee to store up 1 year of food and supplies. Therefore, you won't have to be bothered by standing in line during terrorism and probably diseases of different types and not have to deal with that type of ordeal that's fixing to come up.
So you think that if you take the chip, you're just going to be given a fresh pass, basically like a golden ticket, and you can get through and food, access to other things, essentially, as long as you follow the playbook?
Exactly. Basically, you're going to have a certain amount of rations per month, according to the card. And so you can't buy over that. That's how they're going to, you know, limit who gets what type of food. Even though you have cash, well, they won't allow it. Probably because because they're not going to have enough food. When the bail-in happens, and shortly after that, maybe 3-4 months later, the economy crashes. Farmers can't get a loan to put seed in the ground. Manufacturers may be laying off that are doing the canning and preparation of meats and vegetables. You'd have a breakdown in the economy where the government would have to force people to go to work. And they have this all written out. They have a game, like a game book of FEMA that they plan on following. And
I remember, I was just going to, I didn't mean to interrupt there, Gil. I was just going to jump in because when I was like 14, so this would have been over 20 years ago, I was warned about how eventually when the government does clamp down to a one-world system, the person that was telling me this, his mom was high into the FBI. She had some very, you know, prestigious positions with the Department of Defense, etc. And he was talking about the microchip and the roundups and the FEMA camps and how it was going to be Chinese and Soviets, etc. People not from this country, or UN troops, actually, what he called blue hats, that were going to round people up. But there wasn't a lot of talk about Nibiru or Planet X at the time. It was more just about the one world government. What I'm wondering is if this Planet X is going to cause just catastrophic events and the Georgia Guidestones with the 500 million mark people, etc., maybe that's all connected there. And in order to usher that up, that's why they're going to use the UN troops and everything else, because they knew about this specific cataclysm years ago. Is that a possibility?
I don't know if they knew about it at that time. For sure, they knew about it around 92, maybe even earlier. But they had confirmation by the Pioneer and Voyager probes. If you turn on astronomy software and turn on where they went, and if you have the overlay of the Chinese on what their data shows, you can see how they triangulated the position of this object. And it's coming out of the constellation Sagittarius. That is actually south of the universe. And so they've been known about it since at least 1992. They had confirmation of it. And they've been preparing ever since. Now, I think we're within a couple years, maybe this next year. Don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't tell the future. I'm just saying that the signs that we're seeing on Earth tells me that this item has to be close. We're seeing the orbit of the moon on Saturn warped. We're seeing the orbit of our own moon stretched. You know, it's called perpendations. That can only happen if you have an object that's fairly close. And put it this way, let's say if it's, someone would say it's 16 years away. Well, if we have the effects of what we're seeing right now and it's 16 years away, I would hate to see it when it gets close, because it would be so severe that it doesn't have to pass close to us. But according to the past records, you can look in biblical records as well as other places, you're going to see what's common is a 7-year drought, 7 years or longer. And you see that there's a, when it's mentioning a double eclipse, that can't happen in a natural. That takes a third object to give you two eclipses in the same time period. Because the moon is what causes a solar eclipse. And then the sun and earth is what causes the moon to have an eclipse. You can't have them both at the same time. It's automatically describing they have to have a larger object that give you 3 hours of darkness, because the moon can only give you 7.3 minutes of darkness before the earth will roll out of the shadow. And it only covers only, just a handful of countries. The outside secular records, as well as the biblical records, say the entire earth was darkened for 3 hours. The moon can't do that. That's geometrically, it's impossible. The math does not work out. You can't build a model on that. And it just, remember what science is pertaining to astronomy. If you can take this observed phenomena, bring it into laboratory and show that it's repeatable, that's science. And we have not just proving out the Chinese models, but we've proved out 14 incidents in the biblical records. And 5 secular, where we believe that it's past. And there's mathematical evidence and as well as a sequence of events that people didn't have the knowledge of to fake. They didn't have the physics down. They didn't know that it could do this that level of events in that particular sequence of patterns. It's impossible for them to fake this. That's why when you find something that's fake, you can usually find an error in it, either in the science, the math, or something. When we use the proper science, which is the physics model instead of the astronomy model, we're getting something that works out, that's running an exact match. And that gives us great concern, because this object crosses Earth's path twice, not once, twice. And it has roughly 150 to 152 day and separation between entry and exit. And the biblical records, which is a future event in Revelation, gives astounding information when you know how to process it on this next event. And
have you been able to figure out how many days and nights it's going to be total on the round trip?
You mean what?
So if we were to take both, you know, coming past us, you said it's going to come past us twice. With the orbit, how many days total would that be where it would cause?
Hold on. Okay. Yeah. The planet doesn't pass by us twice. Okay. It crosses Earth orbit twice. It's only by Earth one time, and that's in March, April. event. The next, now it's on its way out. It's going out into deep space. 152 days later, Earth runs into the debris field of the second, you know, wherever it came in at. That the you see, debris field that this thing going to leave behind will carry on for many years after. We will have sporadic meteor showers when we cross those two points again, multiple times in the future. But the most severe is the first two times that we cross. That's where the debris is either the largest or the most concentrated. Later on in years later, it gets lesser and smaller object, we hope. It's something that you can't exactly predict 100% on. And so it only passes near Earth once. Now it should be in the month of March or April, roughly 3.5 days after Passover, according to the biblical records on what we can tell what's going to happen here.
Is it going to cause, you know, some serious Earth displacement, and are we going to see sinkholes and such, very similar to the movie 2012?
Sinkholes would be the minor of your problems.
Okay, right. I'm sure you're right. What about, let me ask you this, Gil, what about being on a big boat or something in the middle of the ocean or off the sound, Puget Sound somewhere, so when everything hits the fan, you've got an opportunity to kind of just, I mean, what, or a submarine or something?
Look, there's huge currents underneath the ocean as well. Just because the waves are whirling on the top doesn't mean you're not bouncing up and down on the bottom. That's a false. You can talk to any submariner. He'll tell you that. It's also sometimes a rough ride underneath, especially when you go in those thermal planes. It really gets to be a wild, wild ride. You'd have less wave action, like in the middle of the Pacific, opposite of Jerusalem area. That's probably where the least waves would be. But I wouldn't risk it. I would choose something like either the Persian Gulf or the Mediterranean would have a better chance of basically surviving if you're in the middle of it, not at the shoreline. Because even those, we will have a sloshing effect in the Mediterranean, because the Bible even says, names three major towns on the Israeli coast, as well as the Nile area being wiped out. So you're going to have some tidal problems in the Mediterranean, but it won't be as severe as the oceans. The oceans, you're looking at waves that we've never seen normally. Every so often when a large ship hits what's called a freak wave, sometimes it'll snap the ship in half because the gaps between the waves and the height of it causes too much stress in the middle of the hull. And the steel structure can't handle multiple hits like that. So even your larger ships will snap in half. The Bible talks about 1/3 of all the ships being destroyed. Talks about 1/3 of all of the trees and grass, and even the rivers and all of your fresh water above ground as well, going to be toxic. When meteors are made of material that can render fresh water not drinkable, at least for a month or two, until it settles out. And not counting the problems that we will have with all of the nuclear facilities not having fuel or their cooling water or their water in their rivers evacuate. Therefore, they don't. It only takes a few hours before a meltdown will start and be completely melted down within 8 to 12 hours later. It doesn't take long. And then after that, it'll make hydrogen, and then the top would blow off, just like it did in Fukushima. Right. We're looking at and that ain't counting all of the majority of the volcanoes going off. That's not counting when the half of the Earth that's facing the plasma of this comet tail, that's like a constant EMP wave hitting that side of the Earth, chances of any electronics working after that is slim to none. So you're looking at no possible way of drawing water out of the ground unless it's manual. And that's, chances are your water wells that you dug, the pipes that you use to dig the well will be sheared because of the shifting of the crust. We're brought back to the Stone Age, basically. And with most of the grass and trees burnt, you don't have any animals, hardly. Most of the animals are gone. And if the grass is gone, that meant a lot of the animals would starve to death. And so it says people will wish death for 5 months before death comes, which is the second event, 152 and 18 days later. There'll be a second meteor shower. That one will come from the nighttime side. The one in March is on the daytime side after a 12-hour delay in Earth's rotation in March. There'll be no rotational delay in the end of August or it's the beginning of September, depending on which month that it enters in. And that one's, we're going to be, according to the, we may be hit by two meteors because the text is a little vague. It seems like it might be mentioned too, but at least one of those is going to be the size of a mountain. And it'll hit Earth so hard that Earth will wobble like a drunkard. Keep in mind, how would they get that correct in a way of, like, that's almost like a satellite view. Remember, he's not saying a hut in their village will shake. He's saying the whole Earth will shake like a hut. All right? Which is realistic in a model if you get hit by that large of a meteor coming in at about 8 to 10 times a rifle bullet, the speed right. of a rifle bullet. It says it splits the Earth. The seas, that sea that it hits, the ocean, will boil. 1/3 of the sea life shall die. 1/3 of the ships will gone. That's not counting all the people that live on the coastline of the Pacific and Indian Ocean. The Bible clearly says that this is the worst time in all of Earth's history. Noah's flood happened, and that's not the worst. This next time is. That is a pretty bold statement.
And also in the Bible, doesn't it say the second time that God decides to cleanse the earth, it's not going to be with water, it's going to be with fire, correct?
Yes, yes. Because, that's what happens. Only half of the earth can go through a meteor shower at any given time. The other half is protected because you're on a globe, a sphere.
You mean the earth isn't flat, Gil?
Well, I'm afraid not.
I'm sorry, I had to throw that out there.
Oh, yeah, I've been bombarded by people, and then I give them one picture, which I pull from their videos, and I tell them, well, the guy didn't calculate elevation. Go measure the elevation of the Sears Tower and the elevation on where he took the picture from. Say it actually proves that the Earth has a curvature to it. Otherwise, you'd see that all of Chicago plus 650 feet of terrain underneath it if the Earth was actually flat. And then they'd want to jump to some other subject. I said, first, you got to answer my question. Prove me wrong. And so that pretty much ends the conversation there when you give them something solid that they can't.
Don't have anywhere to go.
Exactly. So people are being misguided, whether it's intentional or not. If you don't have all of the facts, you get wrong results. It's just like a computer. You put wrong data in, you're going to get wrong results out. It's no different than a calculator or anything else. And that's what most of these people with the flat earth theory is doing. It's not valid.
It's a fascinating phenomenon, though, to watch so many people, you know, go to bat, you know, defending it, saying that it was in the Bible or it was written about and what's a slave planet. And it's just fascinating to see how many people can be taken on a lemmings ride. You know, it's very interesting. I wonder, let me ask you, you think that there was something behind the scenes that kind of pushed that, maybe a mind control op, kind of like a Tavistock Institute or some type of, you know, CIA tactic, MKUltra stuff from the past that's now refined to divert attention somewhere? Do you think that it was just a theory that somebody came up with again, and because it was fresh and new and the way that the internet is, that kind of made a life of its own?
You heard of Christendom, haven't you?
Fresh my memory, if you would, please.
That's a blend of Islam and Christianity called Christendom.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Well, the Muslims believe in a flat earth in the Quran. And a lot of people are buying into this. There is an agenda out there. People need to get a deeper education before they jump onto the wagon of anything. Put your skepticism up. I did. I was a hardened skeptic on this planet. You have to, you know, since nobody out there could prove to me that the planet was real, I did a search. I said, okay, if it did exist, it would be in the Chinese records. And to my surprise, it was. And then I had to try to find Achilles' heel to eliminate it, because I really didn't like the results. And I couldn't. The more I went, the further and deeper the data was there.
How old are those records, Gil?
Oh, the Chinese records go back over 4,000 years.
Okay.
See, most of the other ones they pulled, you only have fragments that they saw something large, a large comet that's called, they blamed it for the plagues. And remember, plagues at that time is more than just disease. And but the last time it passed in the Chinese records, it's in 1054. That's only about 960 years ago. Therefore, you can't have a 3,600-year orbit. Matter of fact, you can go back and almost plot it. If we had to put a time to it, it's closer to 360, but it has a erratic orbit. That's why it was hard to track. And if it wouldn't be for the biblical stories, we could not have plotted that. And it plots out following a formula. It says, well, whenever it had a collision with Ceres, it only came back in 54 to 52 years. And then after that, it was like 130-something years and so on and so on. It was a perfect amount of time if you use a formula, just like we use when we send a space probe and it's running out of speed. We'll let it go around a planet about 3 or 4 times where it reaches its maximum speed, and then we dart it out to a planet. Well, that's exactly what this planet did. It had to go 4 times around the sun before it came back to its original roughly 360-year orbit. They couldn't have guessed that. The way they did, the way the events were timed apart, can't do it. They didn't have the knowledge to better write a fictional story to match it. So,
you've got an image that you showed me a moment before the presentation that has a path that shows how Nibiru will pass by the sun and then go past the Earth. And a lot of people don't really have a reference point for what the orbit of it is, and because that's one of the things I read a lot in different comments, not only on my channel, but others out there like Steve Olson, your channel as well. They'll say, well, you know, how come Nibiru's over here by Jupiter? How come it's close to the sun? I don't think there's really an idea in some people's minds where it's actually coming from and where it's going. Could you show us that picture that has it with that path coming close to the Earth?
All right. Give me just a second here.
Sure. Absolutely. Because I think that just is important for people, that give them a better understanding. And, you know, because that's one of the things I talked to you about before the show also, is I wanted to get into, with all the thousands of photographs that I've got from people that are all around the world, whether it be from webcams in Mexico, sky cams in Hawaii or Georgia, all over the place. And there's these just incredible anomalies. And I think that 90-something percent of them are, you know, probably you can call off as lens flare or some type of just regular anomaly, but there's a few of them there, Gil, that look pretty incredible.
Yeah. Keep in mind, if it's going to be about equal to our sun, or you able to see this right here?
No. No, this is good. Thank you.
So you can see it or you can't?
Oh, I can see it now. I thought you asked if I've ever seen it before. I could see it perfectly.
Okay.
Yeah, we're good. Thank you.
Let's see. Let me move on to this one right here. Okay, you able to see my pointer, correct? That I have on the screen?
I can see the cursor, yeah.
Okay, cursor, okay. See, it enters around this area here on Earth's path, and then it circles the sun, and it comes out about here, exiting. Now, this is where March is at, March, April.
Okay.
Scenario here, okay?
Okay.
Now the planet is heading outward. So now Earth is going to travel 150 days, which is 152 and 1/8 days later. Now it runs into the debris field, which is left over. Okay. So every time Earth is going to come around here, around in these 2 months right here, there's going to be lingering debris that will rain on Earth a little bit. It shouldn't be as bad as these first two events, but it can be sizable. You know, we just don't know, but it should get less and less. But these first two events are going to be some extreme, quite extreme events. And there's some people that says that they're reading the zodiac, like September will be a day. See, this is March, April. September is exactly opposite of that. Whenever you're reading the zodiac, Virgo's over here.
Okay.
Which is, you see, behind the sun whenever you're looking from September. That's why you can't see the stars, because the sun is out. So that's why you have to turn to the zodiac charts to better see this from September. That is the occult version. It's 180 degrees out of sync with the Hebrew Mezerah, which is the Mezerah you use in March, and you look at the nighttime sky. Right here, the sun is opposite of the earth, and you can see Virgo in a nighttime sky. But if you go over here on September, well, the sun is in front of you before you can see Virgo. So you have to turn to charts and software. That's not the way the biblical writings teach us, and this is exactly the opposite, which is the occult. And that's why September is not the month we look in. We look in March and April is where Virgo is in the nighttime sky.
Okay.
So sometime in the future, one of these March or April, and this is also the Chinese, this is the overlay from the Chinese, the Asian astronomers, not just the Chinese, but the Chinese, Korean, and Japanese astronomers that gave us enough information where we can plot a segment of his course. When we do this overlay through the biblical records, we get an exact match to the events. And in the text, it even states that, like for Sodom and Gomorrah, it mentions that Lot was feeding them unleavened bread. That's during the week of Passover. Guess what? That's March or April. Yeshua was crucified when? March or April. It goes on and on and on multiple times. So for this to pass by to cause it 3 days of darkness, where does Earth have to be? March or April. You see?
That's a good connection there.
Yeah, the data points. I'm not making a shallow observation. The data points is there. That's why I'm holding to the data.
Now the Chinese call it the red dragon. The Hopis call it the red kachina. There's been some very powerful red sunrise or sunsets as well lately. Have you noticed more than usual?
Well, it all depends on how much CO2 is in the air.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's the reason why you get these different colors.
It's not the tail of the dragon.
No, I'm afraid not.
Well, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Thank goodness it's not, right?
Yeah. But it will be one time in the future here that will be startling. I'm trying to find a Yeshua sacrifice here, which you see right here. Let me show you this here event. Remember Jonah we had talked about, we touched on?
Yes.
Jonah gave a 40-day warning to Nineveh. Well, from 40 days to where it crosses March, April, this is where it would be behind the sun. But the earth would be over here at the 40-day mark. You can clearly see it. Jonah is given his warning in February and in February, March era. And you can clearly see
you're showing me something here, and then.
Yeah, we have a clear view to see it when Jonah was looking at it at the 40-day mark.
Okay.
Now, if you had an object, remember everything we've seen in the sky pretty much is basically equal to the same size of the sun, all right, because it's called a sun dog.
Okay.
For it to be equal, remember the moon and the sun are basically, the sun and the moon is basically the same size visually to us, okay?
Okay.
Well, our calculations gives us that this planet is somewhere between 6 and 7.5 diameters, all right? larger than Earth.
Okay.
Well, if it's 7 days away from Earth, it should be about 50% the size of the moon or size of the sun. When it gets to about 2 days away, then it's about almost 3.5 times the diameter of the moon. So for it to be equal to the sun, that meant it's somewhere between these two numbers, about between 4 and 5 days away. If you see an object that's almost equal to the sun, that means it should have been here already. Because it's a sun dog. A mirage looks real. And that's what a sun dog is. Under the right atmosphere conditions can be seen anywhere. Okay. And it's just a phenomenon. It's called a sun dog. You can go to Wikipedia and type in sun dog. You see a certain amount of varieties that they show, but there's many more than that. And that's what, when people are not familiar with this, this is what they're seeing.
That's why a lot of times you'll see that, I guess it's a sun dog, as you say, where there's another sun next to the one that's, our typical sun, and it looks almost identical to it. And you're like, well, how does that work? There's one that's the exact same size, or it's a certain distance to where it looks exactly like that. So those, I think, are pretty easy to dismiss. But I've heard different versions of what a sun dog actually is. So, and, I'm looking at this chart, and I got to say, Gil, let's just imagine that this happens within the next couple of years. We're looking, okay, day 7. 50% the size of the moon. Day 2, the further out you get, it gets so big that it's going to freak people out if people don't have a spiritual connection somewhere. I mean, wow.
You have to have both. You have to have also the knowledge of the physics on what to expect and not to be scared and know where to be. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us where to be. He gives us the pivot point. It's going to be somewhere near Jerusalem, because he tells you in Joel, chapter 2, verse 30 to 32, he says, all the ones that call on my name, Yehovah, who are in Jerusalem on Mount Zion, I shall deliver as I promised to them. And he's going to bring them to a place of safety in the wilderness.
How big is Mount Zion?
Well, since most people will be on the ground or hiding in the rocks, caves, whatever, that you're looking at probably... It already tells us only a remnant is going to heed his word. So you're looking at maybe 1.5 million people.
Jeez, that's worse than New York City. Yep. That's going to be pretty packed.
And then about 40% of those people won't make it, because remember, they knock on the door, the place of safety, calling him by the name they think is his name. And he answers them. He says, go away, I don't know you. Now, those are not pagan. Those are not pagan people or other people that knocking on his door, asking to be let in. Those are people that are just misguided. They didn't have the right information, and about 40% would be not in the right place at the right time. And so he's keep in mind the day that. In the biblical, it says there's two taking aways, and they shouldn't be defined and grouped together, because they're qualified completely different. The first one, it's only a remnant, and it specifically says a place and a time to be there. And you're brought to the wilderness. Well, the second taking away, you can be anywhere in the world, and the dead are first, then the living, and then you go to heaven. Well, the first one, it doesn't mention anything about the dead. It says only the living go into the place in the wilderness. And it's only a remnant. Well, the second one says everybody's taken. Now, you either try to combine a contradiction, or it's two separate events. And it's clearly marking two separate events. One is at the beginning of the great tribulation, and one is at the end. And he says, if you make it to the end of this without being in a place of safety, and you make it, count yourself lucky. Very few you will. Because Islam is going to dominate the world, pretty much. Except for that small little place called Israel. And the last battle that they're going to suffer, they're going to lose 3/4 of their northern territory. And they'll be pushed to the Negev Desert. And that's when the two prophets die. And that's when the Muslims stop, because they're celebrating the death of the two prophets. Well, that gives the remnant that's pushed to the desert to fall to their knees and pray for the Messiah to come. And he comes 3 days, 3.5 days later, or three days later. And he if you want to call that rapturing or whatever you want, the dead are first, then the living. So the two prophets are lifted up, plus the other dead, and then the living. How often did Yeshua say, you've heard it said this, but it is written this way? He's trying to say sometimes you hear things that it's not written that way. And he said that multiple times. And go back and read what it literally says. You got to go back to the Hebrew and read what the Hebrew is saying, because there's some contradictions. It's not following us exact. And I didn't believe that until I found it myself. The science in the Hebrew is absolutely correct. We have some problems with the English translations.
So that means that when this thing comes back around the second time, that everybody's gone. It's going to take out everybody.
No, that's only 150 days later. The end of the Great Tribulation, this starts the Great Tribulation.
Okay.
And the Great Tribulation is a total of 3.5 years. But this is going to, remember how it even says the army that attacks Israel will also be on horseback. Well, an EMP wave, wouldn't that put people on horseback for the most part?
It certainly could do that, yeah.
You still have some military equipment which is shielded by EMP, but not all of it. So you're going to have limited modern weapons, but in other words, you won't have enough for a million-man army like the Bible says. They're going to be on horses. Just like it says, it talks about oil lamps. That's not a misprint. Okay, we're going to be burning oil lamps again.
You're taking this literal then.
It's backing up by the science.
Okay.
If you have an EMP, what sort of electron? How long do you think it's going to take to replace flashlights that are most electron? Are electronic because they're LED.
Well, I mean, let me add this real quick, Gil. You bring up a good point because there was a conversation I was having the other day with somebody about their smartphone. And he goes, man, these things are made by aliens, I'm telling you. And he was joking around. I'm like, okay, whatever, dude. And he goes, okay, Rex, go find somebody that could build this phone right now. There's, uh-huh. Good luck finding someone to put that thing together. Maybe, in the factories out there in China, but do they know how to make the microchips?
Well, exactly. I mean, just look at a car, a few million parts, okay? If you have one vendor that's out of that, that car stops. If it's a major part, it doesn't matter how many other manufacturers you have working, it just takes one to stop it. And it's the same thing with your cell phones and a bunch of other things. A lot of our electrical power plants will be out of commission because of the electronics are going to be bad.
Well, they won't be able to stay cold too, because they've got to have a certain cooling system in order, otherwise, like you said, they just blow up.
Well, that's pertaining to the nuclear power plants that are facing the comet tail. Because that comet tail is plasma. And it's going to weaken our magnetic field. And that plasma is probably going to... Remember, it says where the sun is 7 times hotter than normal.
Jeez.
Because of the atmosphere, the protective atmosphere is temporarily removed from that side of the Earth. And so you're getting hit by a pretty a large amount of... radiation, basically, of plasma, and it's going to fry some electronics. It's going to kill a lot of plant life. It's going to, if you're in an open to it, if you're not shielded in a cave or underground facility or some concrete structure, you could get sick from the exposure. And then it's going to be look. I take it literally when it says the worst time in all of Earth's history, because it matches scientifically. You can see it. If these events happen, if we go through it, because the data points in the Bible are a repeat event. Knowing what took place in the Old Testament gives you the data to figure out the last book of the Bible. We didn't have that before. And remember how it says the four angels hold back the wind? Well, that's the way they would say that the Earth stopped rotating. It says where the wise version have two portions of oil. Well, one portion is for a 12-hour night. The wise have two portions to burn through twice as long of a night because Jerusalem side is going to be in the dark for additional 12 hours. The North and South America is going to have 12 hours of additional light because of the rotational delay. And these are two stories, Joshua's long day and these other ones are almost 3,000 years apart.
Right.
Well, they were written closer to 1,000 years apart because that was written, Revelation was written only 2,000 years ago. And Joshua was about 3,000. So, but it's listening, it's giving us the information for this next event, which is predicting the future, if you wish to call it, in exact models that we can reproduce. Remember what science is. You can take the data and reproduce a active model, which came from the Chinese as well as the biblical records, and it matches. I tend to lean on it pretty strong. It's you can't guess this. They didn't have it. They didn't have the physics. They didn't know how the universe worked yet. It's just impossible for them to get this correct.
And if you think about some of the pauses in technology or resets, I should say, you know, there's been so many times in history where these civilizations seem to be in a thriving moment and then they just disappear, or they don't necessarily disappear, but their civilization falls very quick. And some of the plagues and such that you brought up that are possibly connected to Wormwood or Planet X or Nemesis, it brings up some really thought-provoking ideas. And, you know, I keep looking at this chart, Gil, and I'm telling you, man, if it's 50 times the size of the moon, I mean, that's – and somebody sees that.
Visual perspective, yes, that's your visual perspective. That means that roughly if it's this size that we're claiming – let me show you some data here. You can go ahead and I have to find it for you. Right here. So you have 250,000 miles between the Earth right here and the Moon right here. 250,000. Well, that's roughly 30 diameters of Earth. You can fit 30 Earths between the Moon and Earth again, okay? This object's only roughly six to seven times the diameter. And the Roche limit, which is this halo that I have around Earth, which is 1.5 times the diameter or radius of Earth, is the Roche limit. That's the limit of gravity. Anything beyond that is the magnetic fields that's holding things in place. This is where you get geosynchronous orbit after the Roche limit. Well, if this has the similar mass or electromagnetic field, which we don't know what it is, but I'm just doing a parallel. I'm giving it equal.
Sure.
1.5 times this radius. Well, you see this halo. So it won't drag us into outer space unless it gets closer than halfway. It'd have to get considerably close. And it could, because it says this next one is the worst time in all of Earth's history.
So this thing could actually drag us out somewhere different into the solar system, you're saying?
If it came close enough to where it got into the gravity fields, yes. If the two gravity fields crossed long enough, yes, it could drag. Remember Hezekiah?
No.
When the shadow went backwards on Hezekiah. Well, this is what took place. It drug us slightly. Hold on. Let me get the data here for you.
That'd be an interesting adventure, catching a ride with a giant planet. Now, there's also a lot of speculation that there's various moons that orbit several planets, and then the Red Kachina, the planet 7X, you call it, is this dwarf star. So that is that the dwarf star, or is that like a planet itself?
I think our books are going to have to be rewritten. I don't believe planets can be anything close to what a star is. It's not that they had enough gravitational pull and mass to ignite its own atmosphere.
Okay.
I don't believe a sun even works in that way. I think it works on a different method of plasma. Plasma comes into the north and south pole, and it radiates out from its axis of its center. Across these planets, and that's called the solar winds. So I just don't see that happening with a planet that just happened to have more mass. I think we have to. So I don't buy into this this brown dwarf theory because of it's in light of what the physicists have come up with.
And you think it's just one planet then?
Yes, it may have a few moons, but there's no data to support that. But I have no answer for that 12th star on Leo, not until it shows up. It may have a small fragment of a moon that would make, which might make up that 12th star for Leo. Now, you see, this is this drawing I have in front. This is Hezekiah.
Okay.
All right. Well, this is where there's a discrepancy between the English and the Hebrew. The English says it was a sundial that went backwards 10 degrees. In the Hebrew, literally, it states that it went back on steps. Okay. Let's see if I can find it here. See, this is the King King James going down in a dial of Azar, which people thought it was a like a sundial. But right here in the Hebrew, stairs, it steps right here, steps. Okay? And there's the shadow that went back on steps. Well, so if it's a sundial, it's east to west. That the earth would have to stop on it. It would have to stop on a dime, needs to reverse, stop on a dime again, and go back to its original time because there was no delay of hours at the end of the day. Well, that would empty out all of the oceans onto the continent. And he doesn't even state that in the document at all. So if we go literally what it says, if it steps and you face the steps south, okay, then that's a tilt of the earth at 26 to 28 degrees. It's a north-south tilt right here. If you have shadow on the steps, which this, you can tell the seasons on where the shadow is on the steps, okay? And you can go 10 steps, and guess what? That gives you 26 to 28 degree tilt. We can prove that Earth tilted between 3 to 4 times in its past of this exact amount. So this... it passed so close to Earth, it caused us to have a tilt because it's like two bar magnets, opposite poles attract, and they tilted towards each other. Okay? And it takes about 6 hours for its approach to do that. And as it's leaving, it takes 6 hours for it to straighten out roughly again. And it comes close to its original position. It could be anywhere from 3 to 7 degrees off. And that's what caused some of these mini ice ages before, because our seasonal changes are caused by Earth's tilt, not by how close we are from the sun. Because North America, remember, when we're having winter, Miss Australia is having summer because of the tilt.
Now, that's another thing, too, is I've heard that because the Earth has moved off of its axis and the poles have shifted somewhat because of this giant anomaly out in the heavens, you know, Planet X, Wormwood, Nibiru, whatever name you want to put to it, that some areas are a lot more extreme. You know, you're going to have a lot more sun and heat in specific areas that didn't have that type of temperature years ago. But then other parts of the world are more cold and there's ice that's, you know, more ice there now than there was 10 years ago.
Remember those mammoths that got frozen?
Yes.
Where the food was still in their mouth. They didn't have time even to swallow the food they had in their mouth. They were flash frozen because of the tilt. Cold winds from the Arctic. Before they knew it, within 6 hours, they were in the, you know, within a short time, that cold freezing wind hit them. And you're frozen. And this is an archaeological find of Hezekiah's seal that was just found recently. It shows a winged disc right here. The wings represent movement through the sky. The dish is our planet. And the writing on here says, belonging to Hezekiah, son of Asher, king of Judah. And this is one of the only seals that was ever found for Hezekiah. Hezekiah, you see, documented this event on his seal because it was the way God answered his prayer. He wanted to know, he wanted proof that he was going to live another 15 years, as the prophet told him. He says, well, what do you want? You want the shadow to go forward or backwards? He says, make it go backwards, because that's basically it's impossible. And God tilted the earth and made the shadow go backwards. And that's how he got his answer.
You know what this looks like? This is similar to some of those hieroglyphs in Egypt, also the Anunnaki symbols from the Sumerian tablets that they talk about, you know, the return of Planet X or whatever. They had the interesting similarities there.
Yeah, many cultures have put a flying disc because they're describing this object. Now, they'll give it different names because they didn't have word planet or anything like that. See, we even give it a name. I did. Planet 7X. It has multiple names. It's called Baal. It's called Jupiter. It's called Zeus. It's called Horus. It's called multiple pagan gods, because that's what it caused so much mystic destruction. They were sacrificing young babies even under Baal worship. Because of the severe drought, they would sacrifice children for this planet to give them their weather back.
Gil, you know they're building 1,000 of those temples right now around the world?
Yep.
Think there's a connection there?
Yeah. The adversaries are the one, you know, the fallen angels are, the Bible calls them, Elohim does not mean G-O-D, it means authority figure. Okay? These are the authority figures that's put on. They're the ones pulling the strings behind the scenes. They're going to try, from what I understand, remember Von Braun of NASA told his secretary great details on what they were going to do in the future. And one of them is that they were going to mimic an alien, crafts coming down as being friendly, giving us high-tech stuff. And that was one of the things that they were going to try to fool the public with. And he was letting his secretary know about this. You see this view right here that I have here on the screen?
Yes.
See, this planet can either pass to the right or to the left of Earth. See, if this planet would have passed to the right of Earth, then Earth would have also tilted, but also go through the meteor shower. The debris field. But because it passed on the left side of Earth, Earth didn't go through the plasma tail. So there was no rotational delay. So Earth tilted as it was still spinning. Okay. So there was no.
Okay.
And there was no meteor shower. But there was a meteor shower 5 months later, because there was an army parked outside of Missy Jerusalem, ready to invade. And Hezekiah was worried about his own life also at the time, you know, and he put up a bunch of defenses. Well, the king of the Assyrians marched his army there. I think it was 185,000 soldiers. And they went to sleep to get up the following morning to go to battle. When the king woke up the following morning, all of his soldiers were dead. And there's some other outside documents I have in here, right here, I have it written, where some writers had figured it was fire from heaven that had killed him. So 5 months later is where Earth passes through the second meteor shower, you know?
Jeez.
So it wiped out that army. The timing here is incredible. Only God can create the timing.
What's your thought on Zechariah Sitchin and the Anunnaki?
I'm not cutting down the man in any kind of way, but I'm looking for hard data. He has stories coming from the clay tablets, but there's no way of substantiating the claim with hard data. The Chinese gives us orbital path of it. It says where it was in the sky, exact time, dates, and places.
What's the name of those documents, Gil?
All right.
Just so our listeners could look it up, because I know that people are going to ask me that after this if I don't give them a reference point.
Sure. It's one of the main one is the re-misevaluation of Eastern and Western records of the supernova of 10-1054. And there's some other ones that are free. Let me get this up here.
I appreciate this. And our audience will as well, so thank you.
Way at the beginning here, so. Okay, here it is. This is the one that I was able to plot. And it's called the Reevaluation of Eastern Western Records of Supernova 1054 from the Dublin Institute of Advanced Studies. Then there's this one right here, the Chinese guest star. This is what the Chinese called it. They also called it a fiery dragon, you see, of old. But it's called a guest star. And the Crab Nebula by Ho Ping Yang, or Yolk, whatever his name. And this is out of the New York Public Library. This article came before the other one, but they're almost identical. And
That's cool. I appreciate you showing that to us. This will give a lot of people an option now to look into that. So that's fascinating. I'm going to do more research on that as well.
You see, like right here, this is that first one I showed you, the paper. It shows you the Chinese above it.
Uh-huh.
It shows the interpretation behind it. And when you take this and it gives you, see, I converted what a Chinese inch was, okay, compared to Miss Imperial. And they measure things from the length of an arm, holding a ruler out, eyeing it, okay? So they said from this star right here, which is in Taurus, okay, 9.18 inches. So I can do this on a star chart because we know visually how many degrees stars are missing apart. So I can tell from there's already known data at the length of a person's arm what that would look like as far as inches. So I drew a circle here. And this object has to be on the ecliptic. You see this line that goes around. For it to cross Earth pathwise, has to be on the ecliptic. They saw this when the sun was just rising. It was just in front. It had a tail. So it was right here, right at the point right here. And they give the exact measurement. But when I go through all of the records and look at, say, I show a looking down at the, from the polar north of the universe, which is
okay.
It's called Nadar. You're looking down at the solar system. That's what this here view is. Along with the orbit, it shows where the object was at the time. And then this view right here is where it looked like on the sky, following the Chinese. And we went through all of the records, and it gives us a segment of its course. And it was just absolutely, it's astounding. For you to see an object 13 months coming in without a telescope and 13 months leaving, that has to be an extremely large object. That's over a year coming in and over a year leaving. So then this is, you know, a more easy way of referencing it. Then I came back and I plotted on what days other places have stated seeing objects, but they would only give general reference, like they may say in the morning or noon or evening, but they wouldn't say the constellation. So the only ones that would give us the exact points to be able to plot this is the Asian records. But I went ahead and misincluded when all these other ones, like Rome saw it at the death of a pope, Constantinople in Turkey saw it, London saw it, Baghdad saw it, Rome, East Armenia, Ireland, it's dated. And these are just some of them. These are some of the records that I was able to find. But there's more. So
yeah, this is some of the most detailed accounts I've seen, Gil.
Yeah, well, because most people, look, it usually takes a team of astronomers working together. I was alone. So you have to, it would take, you know, I spent 12, 14 hours a day processing the information. And then also doing the graphics to where it could be explained easier to people.
Well, and for those that are listening to us, I'd just like to remind you, check out Gil's website, planet7x.net. Also a fantastic YouTube channel, Planet7X on Facebook. Pick up the movie Planet 7X as well, because there's just so much information that's going to be in there that we probably won't have the time to cover here as well. So,
see, this is a encyclopedia right here.
Okay.
This was in 1979, July 23rd. It states in there that the scientists at that time, remember, this was before 92 when they went silent. They said it was 4.7 billion years away. Well, when we reverse the exact model, the Chinese model on our orbit right here, look what we have, 4.67. Matter of fact, we have to add a year to that because I was estimating it being in 2016. But it probably would be 2017. So it's right on the mark. And this was in a missing encyclopedia. You can see here on another one right here. This is Science Digest of 1982, astronomy. They said between 4 to 7. Boy, they got big, didn't they? They separated the numbers. You saw how they had a point number on the other one, but this one they got 4 to 7 billion. Well, when we reverse it to the time frame, we get 4.3, or, you know, about 4.4 billion. So they're trying to stretch the numbers because they don't want to worry people. For some reason, areas were blacked out here, didn't handle this very well. Ames, okay, here's in the Ames research. The astronomers are so sure of a 10th planet that they think there's nothing left but to name it.
Let me ask you this too. Hasn't there been recently a whole bunch of deaths with astronomers, and the majority of them, they say it's either a car wreck or some type of suicide? Have you heard about that?
Oh, yes. There's quite a few. We can't say for sure, but put it this way, I would say their life insurance premiums are going up right now on astronomers looking for Planet X, I would say.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
It's just untimely for Dr. Harrington, who was not going to be quiet. He wrote papers. I wish I have his papers. Let's see if I have it. Someone's out there quoting him absolutely wrong just to make people think that it's the 3600 year. And his actual reports, he actually states, I think it's 1,019 years, I think it is.
Okay.
Let's see right here. This is the actual office paper. Now, I give you the article, right, a number to look at, the date.
Uh-huh.
He did this in 1988. He died in 1993. Okay, he's given an estimate here, okay, because he hasn't spotted it yet. But according to the perpetrations and everything, he's saying it's 1,019 years, not the 3,600 years that some people are claiming that Dr. Harrington said. He didn't say that. He never did. And he also says he roughly thinks it might be 4 to 6 times Earth's mass. You know?
So saying a lot of the same stuff you're hitting on.
Yeah, I'm just a slightly larger, but since we don't know what material it's made out of, remember this object collided with Ceres and it destroyed a planet, and yet it survived to come back multiple times after that. That has to be either a steel object or something very close to that is very large. Remember in the Bible, it talks about a very unusual incident that I cannot explain. It talks about this guy was cutting, he borrowed an axe to cut down a tree by a lake. And as he was cutting, the axe head loosened and it went into the lake. And then the prophet was there, you know, he said, man, what I'm going to, you know, this farmer was asking, like, what I'm going to do? I've lost this man's axe head. And the prophet said, watch, look. And the steel axe head floated a short while later. Now, if this, I can't find the timing of this, but if, let's say this object is that dense, that it's metal, that the magnetic pull might be larger than what we'd expect. Well, what it did to the steel, it made it almost buoyant, less with less weight. It would be a very spooky event if all the sunken ships were buoyant at one time and come to the surface whenever this planet passes. That would freak out some people.
Yeah, are people going to turn into like zombies, such as what you see on TV, possibly because of the difference with the electromagnetic fields? Have you heard of that theory?
No, it'd probably be more violence, yes, but no, not exact, no. I'm not into the... remember how...
The zombie apocalypse!
Yeah. Remember, humankind has lived through this before in the past, just that this time is going to be worse. And most people lost basic skills. They don't know how to butcher an animal from the field and cook it from scratch, or pick herbs, or survive off the land under difficult conditions. They're totally dependent on someone making it for them. So unless these people are in the right place at the right time, as the Bible says to be, they have very little chance. There's going to be a large population decrease. It's happened in the past. Look, if you were to take normal genetics, that's a wrong word, calculating human population growth, okay?
Okay.
We have equal about 7 billion people right now. And if you reverse that, okay, and if you reverse that model to figure out how many people there would be, let's say if you just started with two people from right now and went back and, you know, started about 2,000 years ago, which is the time of Yeshua, you'd have trillions of people today with just normal, you know, numbers, not mis-exaggerated numbers, trillions. We had to have massive amount of plagues, deaths, meteor showers, something that was taking place. Wars don't calculate for that, not to that extent. So, right. So Earth, remember the Dark Ages?
Oh, yeah.
This object passed twice to our unit. It didn't come close to Earth now. Remember, it only came close to Earth 3 to 4 times. But the other time that it came through our solar system, Earth is in a different month. And we may get a meteor shower 2 to 3 to 4 months later. Just like this picture right here. Let's see here. There's a painting that shows fire from heaven coming down, and it's
you've really got a nice layout on your presentation, Gil. I applaud you for that. You put these together nicely.
Well, thank you. When I do give a presentation to people, you know, I kind of expect them to be a skeptic, exactly like what I was, and I want to see something that is closest that we can get, you know, to convince me that this is a real real object. But you see this painting right here? Mm-hmm. It shows two comet-like objects in the heaven.
Right.
Well, Halley's Comet passed during this time period. So you can explain that. This is during around the Dark Ages or so. So what's the other object? Now, Halley's Comet does not cause earthquakes, famine, and meteor showers. And it doesn't snap trees in half. If you look at the trees in the middle of this, you can see that they're broken in half. Let me zoom in a little bit for you. You see the trees in the middle?
Oh, yeah.
You can see how the buildings are broken up. Some of them look like they might start on fire. You can see how they're broken right here. And mm-hmm. You can see how the land is lifted up here. You can see a fall right here.
Right.
You can see how the people are holding their belly like they're hungry or starving.
We're having a heart attack. Like this one guy's got his hand over his heart here.
Huh. Right. So.
The dogs are okay, though. They're eating the carcasses of the dead people.
Yeah. they did in the dark age. It was documented about that. But Halley's Comet does not cause these effects. But our planet does. Our planet does.
How old is this painting?
It was estimated, let's see. Wait, I got to go to the bottom out here. Around 1456.
Okay. Jeez.
It's during the dark. It passed twice during the dark age. This is where Europe had a lot of the meteor showers and stuff.
Okay.
And keep in mind, they didn't have words for it. So, you know, but... That's what set them back. It caused the plagues. Some of these were not the normal plague of disease. It was some of the plagues of what this thing caused. And so you have a combination of things that are going on. So there is data. It's whether or not we choose to look at it as add data. People tend to write off the ancient people as very not as intelligent, or I think we don't give them enough credit for the past. They had enough knowledge to know what was coming even at certain time. Remember, there's certain civilizations in around Turkey that went underground. This entire town went underground. They built cities underground.
That's right.
Well, a meteor shower would drive people underground. And this is a chart that I use for Revelation. This lower section is seal six. If you follow the seals, that talks about what's going to happen right down here. And it says that 5 months later, seal seven, that's this one, where Wormwood, a large meteor, is going to hit Earth, where Earth wobbles like a drunkard. In Isaiah right here, are you able to read that?
Yes, the Earth is broken up. Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. Okay. This is because this large meteor is hitting us. And this is where he says the Earth is broken up, the Earth is split, the Earth is violently shaken, the Earth reels like a drunkard, it sways like a hut in the wind. Wouldn't that be an accurate description from space, looking at Earth being hit, if it was hit by a fiery mountain?
I mean, that's pretty intense.
Now, if you read, is it this one? I think it's this one right here. No, let's go down. Let me see what it says. This is where it says the fish of the sea and the birds of heaven are having a problem. Beasts of field.
Uh-huh.
It says face of earth is shaken. And there's another one. I don't have it on this particular.
Mountain shall be thrown down. That's.
Yeah. I have another. On my newer one, another little scroll piece that talks about where night will become day and day will become night. Now, that's literally talking about a 12-hour delay in Earth's rotation. When you put those two together in the same sentence.
You know, we're looking at what's going on right now in the current state of affairs, and with the news reports coming out and openly admitting that there is a Planet X out there, but they're given different locations on where it is. All right, where are some places in the U.S. that you feel would be safe for people to go to? Because most people aren't going to be able to make it out to Jerusalem, realistically.
Well, I don't really try to recommend that because people will seize on that, so I will have to pass on that. But the Bible clearly says nowhere on earth you should live on a coastline. Okay. I would say at least 100 to 200 miles away from the coast. 150 at least. Anywhere along the coast. And that includes the Great Lakes or any large body of water, because when the Earth starts to tilt, that water in those lakes are going to either move north or south, or it's going to, you know, water wants to stand still while the crust is moving until it catches up to speed. So, living by a large lake can be hazardous.
Be a lake or something. And then also, if the poles do shift, then some places that are currently cold are going to have a warmer climate at that specific time. Do you think that having a year's supply of food is good, 6 months, longer than that? What would you recommend?
Well, if they don't plan to be on Mr. Jerusalem, then they have to try to make it through the Great Tribulation.
Okay, and you said that's 3.5 years, right?
3.5 years plus this one year right now that you're supposed to have as well, because they're going to start rationing food. So you can't buy your food after rationing, because it doesn't matter how much money, they're not allowing it. So you have to buy it before the bail-in happens.
Okay.
And
you think that's going to happen, the bail-in, are you referring to like similar to what happened back in 2008?
No, I'm saying we haven't seen anything like what's fixing to come here.
Like Depression, early 1930s style, or 1920s?
I would say more encompassing. That was just more or less local. We're talking about global bail-in almost. Anything financial, because it's a global system today. We have global markets.
Indeed.
So we haven't seen anything like what's fixing to come here. I can... One of the things we can talk about, I don't think we talked about, did we, about the need for disk?
No. No, this is new to me.
This is a artifact that was found by some treasure hunters that was illegally hunting for treasure, ancient artifacts. And they found as they tried to sell it on the black market, they were caught. And what this ended up being is the oldest documented event in the sky with this star pattern, moon, sun, and everything. It goes back over 3,000 years or more. It goes down. It goes all the way back to the time of Joseph of Egypt. And this is the oldest artifact in Europe. It was found roughly, let me see, I'll show you this, in Nebra colony, which is about 20 miles away from Gothic Germany, right down here.
Okay.
And why is Gothic important? Because they have the oldest observatory in Europe right here. I believe that this was built at this observatory. It's only one day's walk away. Okay. So, and there are certain characteristics on this disc that match this area. Like this, you see this, they had built a dam right here in this area right here.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So they rerouted the river. The old river went down here, right next to the town, okay, where that red line is. Well, that is this curvature at the bottom right here. This was the horizon in front of the viewers at this observation hill right here. This is a hill. So they were able to see the river. So they put this right here, meaning the river. This is the western horizon here, and this is the eastern. And then what they did right here is they put these dots on this bronze plate representing the constellations and planets. Well, right here is Gemini. Right here is Capricorn. And here's an easy one to spot, which is the Seven Sisters, which is called Pleiades. And then this is the constellation Orion. Well, this is the sun. You can't see stars out if the sun's out unless it's in an eclipse mode. But the problem with that is the experts fail to miss that it shows the moon in a crescent shape. The expert is saying that this is a normal eclipse. It takes a full moon, a new moon, which is totally darkened, to cover and darken the sun. You cannot use a crescent shape, because we keep in mind that the illuminated side has to face the sun. This moon is facing the wrong direction. The illuminated side has to be flipped over. So that tells you it's either to the right or to the left of the sun. It's not in front of it for you to have a crescent shape. And that changes the day that this is referencing to from, I think, a 6 day is what they estimated. Actually, it's 22 and a half days later. So they're looking at the wrong time frame according to the crescent. And so when you correctly, let me see, determine this, you end up getting an exact date because of these planets right in here. They're like a Swiss watch. And that gives you this date right in here. Let's see if I have it here. Right here. There it is. The software gives us a date of April 6, 1810 BCE. But remember, I was telling you how the year got extended during Hezekiah. It was documented through
right.
many of the civilizations that the calendar changed from 360 to 365 and a quarter day year. Well, the software doesn't compensate for the year going back to 360, so you have to subtract 16 years from that. That gives you April 6, 1794. Well, that gives you the exact time of the mid of drought of Joseph of Egypt, which was documented by the Germans in Europe.
Huh.
And this, remember Joseph, when he said this, he had a dream that God showed him at age 17, that someday the skies will bow to him.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was interpreted as if it was his entire family that was going to bow to him, like he was going to be a superior or a supervisor or somebody of some importance.
Okay.
Well, he wasn't in Egypt until he was 40. I mean, when this thing passed, he was around 40 years old. And let me see if I have a, and the, right here, the this is Germany, the latitude of Germany. For Germany to see the this constellation right here, Orion, you see this red line across the top?
Yeah.
That's the latitude of Germany. That's all that they can see. They can't see this constellation. Not until you get to Luxor, Egypt, you can see it. Which means Earth tilted 26 degrees. And so Joseph, during the nighttime sky, he tilted 26 degrees. And what did it look to him? Like the skies bowed to him, literally. His dream at age 17 came true at age 40. And that was mid of the 7-year drought. He had 3.5-year drought coming in and 3.5-year drought as it was leaving.
That's an interesting chart that you've got there. Now, yeah, that's what I was talking about earlier, what I brought up, that specific symbol right there in the center. Looks kind of like what you were showing us earlier in the presentation.
Well, you see how this disc right here is in the middle of horns?
Oh, yeah.
Well, let me show you the relationship to that. Here's Taurus. This planet is in Taurus.
Okay, and then it's during got the
time,
horns.
During the time, that's what they were showing.
Okay.
Because they had their own constellation markers of this as well. That's throughout their tombs, even in some of their tombs, some of their writings show all of these. They learned it from maybe the Hebrews. The Hebrews had it a long time back. How to interpret. So, and then first it was a winged disc, okay, right here, you know, this with a wing. Then later on, you know, there's some sort of creature, okay. You see this thing in his hand? That's a key to the underworld. Okay, a lot of death happening or hiding underground, a key to the underworld. Then later on, the royal family want to be just as powerful as the gods. So they made themselves with these symbols, showing that they are kin or relatives to the god. Through time, the authority figures linked themselves to it so they could rule over the peasants. As they're doing today.
Let me ask you this. Do you think that the pharaohs of yesterday, you know, previously thousands of years ago, these had these like cone head type shaped skulls? Now, obviously, they found that some of them were done self-inflicted, but I'm not convinced on all of them. Do you think that there's a possibility that this planet X or Nibiru has life on it, and that could be the connection with the Book of Enoch and the fallen angels and the watchers that's discussed?
See, if you mix the two, then you're mixing data in a way. One's false, one is true. Remember, Enoch's telling you, they never left Earth. They're here. Fallen angels, if you want to call them that, messengers, the word angel means messengers, were put on Earth. And they've been living here with us as the word Elohim. Remember how it says they're the fallen sons of God? Well, that word is Elohim. And Elohim doesn't mean G-O-D. It means authority figure. They were the because there's only one son of God, not multiple. They were the sons of an authority figure that fell, the messengers. They're still here today in some form or fashion because the Bible tells us they rule over us in a way in the background. Now, Mars is, there's scientific calls this Goldilocks zone where Earth is. It's exactly the right distance to have water in the different states that it needs to have life. Mars is too far away. It's on the edge. It probably it'd be difficult. So an object that far in space, that deep, no, I don't expect life to be there. And it passes so close to the sun, it would boil lead almost. So I don't see it happening.
Okay.
But that's what they want to pass off, Bill, to you. Von Braun said that.
So that's the deceiver, basically, or that's the way to make
exactly.
It as if, okay, well, we're so far away, we only come around every 3,600 years, so don't worry, it's okay.
Exactly. That's the deceiver. That's what they do. They deceive. Remember, I was showing you these right here?
Mm-hmm.
Aren't they deceiving the public right there, that they're relatives to this mighty object? The pharaohs and the queens were saying that they're basically a relative to the that they came from this planet and that they're the chosen ones. History repeats itself.
Yes, it does.
That's all it does. You just have to understand history a little bit better. But history repeats itself.
It's just more technologically advanced now. You know, I asked earlier, do you think it's going to be like the Depression? I mean, it's going to be more of 1984, except for the advanced technology is even beyond that now. So if they want to clamp down on things, there might be some, you know, there's always that talk of the mark of the beast, Gil, and people are like, well, I'm not going to take the chip. And I'm sure many people won't, but if they really wanted to, they could put some type of tracking device on us now. They can track people by their heat signatures, their voice fluctuations, their walk, their stride. I mean, there's so many different ways to track individuals, and with the supercomputers and algorithms that can run quadrillions of floating points per second, it's pretty easy to predict future outcomes of people. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens when they start to clamp down on personal freedoms and declare martial law. So,
remember, Bush gave a comment one time. He said, if America wanted to send troops with their full technical gear, when they would land in Iraq, they would be considered almost aliens. The people would think that they were aliens with the super technology gear they had, that they had on. He said that. I didn't. He said it.
Sure.
You haven't seen the high-tech equipment yet. You haven't seen it yet.
Well, I mean, they've got space tech weapons. Remember when China wasn't playing ball with the global market and they kept lowering the value of the yen? So what happened? Boom! That enormous explosion at one of the chemical plants. The official version was, oh, well, you know, the chemicals got mixed together and it caused these just, do you remember there was hundreds of those 42-foot containers?
Yeah, but it wasn't one chemical. It was like three or four that went off.
Well, it better have been 3 or 4 million. I mean, that was like nuclear or something. I don't know about nuclear, but they had a lot of speculation that it was some of that new space tech weaponry called the Rod of God that uses these directed energy weapons from space. I mean, it certainly didn't look like a chemical weapon unless they were building bombs in that facility. Did you see the pictures? I mean, there were hundreds of those containers that were getting they were thrown around like twigs in a tornado.
Okay. Yes. And it was, more than one. That's why, just like you, I was kind of, it's very unique that at least three went off within a week.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. The one plant in Japan too, huh, Gil?
I think all three of them were in China. I think Japan came later, but, yeah. In other words, whoever doesn't want to play ball with the globalists, they will make sure you do one way or another. You know, some of these people don't want to play nice in the sand. In a sandbox. Well, there's a bully in it. And they're, it's going to be difficult for the average human, average person coming up. I'm all for following what the biblical data is telling me to do and where to be. These are not vain religious acts. It has nothing to do with that. It's actually hard data, meaning everything he told us, even down to what foods to eat, is designed for your benefit.
Don't they talk in the Old Testament like you're supposed to shave with a dull blade and stuff like that too, though? I mean, that's kind of...
It might be translated. I'm not quite sure about that comment. That's the first time I hear that. But so far, anytime I find something that stands out that you can't make sense, first thing I do is I turn to the Hebrew or the Aramaic or some ancient writing and look at it from that point of view on that period of time. You have to have a mindset. This is a Middle Eastern text written by Hebrews with their own set of customs. And you have to get in that mindset before you even read it. So I had to learn a little bit about Paleo Hebrew, ancient Hebrew, before I got to modern Hebrew, because that's where I could recognize what was being said. You got to do the walk. Without the walk, you're like a blind man with a cane. Very difficult for you to find your way.
That's a good point. Now, so the Joseph of Egypt, that's the 7 years of plenty, 7 years of drought. What other, have you found accounts like in Native American, you know, the Native American accounts besides the Hopi prophecy with the Red Kachina? Have there been other ancient texts as well?
Yes, there's numerous ones, but they don't have the hard data. That's why I'm not using them.
Okay.
But I can see where... Just like the Mayans, let's see here. We'll go to the Mayans for a moment.
And you think that there are cycles that they talked about, as well as the end of the cycle at 2012, had something to do with Planet X, or is that completely different?
Well, I'll let you make up your own mind which ones I point this out.
Okay.
Okay, this is where the Aztecs and the Mayans were living in that area of Mexico. And if you take a look at their calendar and you look on the outside rim right here, all on the outside rim right here, you see this right here? Take a close look at it. Now, keep in mind, this is carved in rock.
Looks like Space Invaders.
It could be, but I kind of recognize that almost like a comet. You got the core.
Uh-huh.
And you have, the tail of a comet, then possibly some meteors in the background or whatever.
Okay.
I'm not quite sure what the dots mean. Not sure. But when you pair these as an entry and exit, I come up with almost the same amount of times since the Mayans were alive and when they were keeping record going back to Noah's flood. So they have different counts. One of them that's talked about is a Bakhtun, but they had different lengths of counts. And then, so they just picked a Bakhtun and said, well, this was part of the count, but they didn't tell the public about their other counts. Well, the last one they had, yes, it was a Bakhtun, a unit of measure. Guess what? That happens to be exactly the length of time between when Constantine seen it and when the Mayans went through this severe drought where about 80 to 90% of the population died because they couldn't support the crops and the water table dropped. So exactly what a Bakhtun was, 395 years apart, because we know when Constantine, because it's documented in history. That's what Constantine saw. He saw this star rounding the sun. And he documented it. This was our planet coming out. It makes a star, like a starburst. And it's throughout history, if you look.
Jeez. Just building all these nuclear reactors, just absolutely stupid. Because with these type of events, there's no way to protect them.
Absolutely correct. That's like Murphy's Law. They didn't plan for a major disaster of this type. We should never have built them. But I think the adversaries wanted that built. Remember, the adversaries I'm talking about is the fallen angels.
Yeah.
Because their job is to eliminate the seed of humans. It's not here to benefit them. They just want a slave race. Isn't that what they talk about on the stones even? That's enough to serve them?
The stones are interesting, Gil, if you actually read them, except for a couple of things in there. I mean, it sounds pretty good. It's like, okay, have peace and balance with nature, make sure to help others kind of thing, create a harmonious language so everybody will understand each other. So, I mean, there was some pretty cool things there, but of course, at the very first, they have to say no more than 500 million people.
Yeah. Yeah, well, didn't Hitler say a very cool thing for most of his people? They jumped on the bandwagon. And then when he started doing horrible things, it was too late to stop him.
Right.
Don't they entice you always with nice things?
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, take a look at this picture here that I'm showing you. That picture to the right there is one that I took in China when I was there off of a bronze bell. Okay. This is the fiery dragon. You see the clouds behind?
Mm-hmm.
You see this planet in the middle. It has lightning coming off of it. Okay. And this is a fiery dragon of old, according to Chinese. You see how they're astronomical units? They had dragons on the corner?
Yeah.
Because they were paid astronomers. They wanted to know when this thing was coming so the kingdom could buy food from the neighbors and stock up. Just like our own government's doing right now. They're stocking food.
Amongst other things, food, seeds, water, ammunition, cardboard cutouts of grandma with a handgun.
Homeland Security bought enough ammunition to have a war equal to Iraq for 35 years.
Isn't that interesting?
So I guess they just want to have it in case,
Oh, yeah. I mean, they didn't have anything else to spend the money on, so I figured buying that much ammunition would be a good idea.
Yep.
Looks like the Predator with the tail, that one dragon picture you got there. Chinese guest star, 10-50. Yeah, yeah. Remember the movie The Predator? The face right there, and then it's got the dragon tail. That's a really neat picture.
Yeah, that was off of a bronze bell that was extremely old. And it goes back many, 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 many centuries. They've been tracking it. This is why the Mayans were so interested in tracking. This is why the Chinese were so interested, because of the devastating droughts and meteor showers and everything. They wanted to know so they could prepare. And that's exactly what our own government is doing, and the Vatican is doing, and other governments are doing. They're monitoring. They want to know when it's coming back.
Do you think that's why they named that telescope Lucifer, the Vatican did?
Well, the actual word in Greek for Lucifer was illuminated, illuminated one. That's not actually the name of Satan. If you you can actually find the name of that, I think, in the book of Jasher or Enoch, one of those books that are outside the Bible. It gives the literal name of the fallen angels, and there are 12.
Not the lesser key of Solomon.
Hmm?
Not the lesser keys of Solomon, right? Those are the 72 lesser keys, the lower entities that some say are fallen angels or demons.
I don't know. I don't know. I never heard that term used before.
Okay.
So I can't comment on it, but it's stated in the books that are outside the Bible. If you get the Book of Enoch or the Book of Jasher or Jubilee and all them. So if you go back to the original meaning, often this stuff is talking, because this planet is also can be called, remember, the word Satan means adversary.
Uh-huh. True.
Okay. So when you bring Hebrew back to the original meaning, this planet is an adversary against Earth. Okay. As they look, because it shows movement. They think it's somewhat alive. You know, it has movement. So in their terms of using Hebrew, they would say it's an adversary. Okay. A mighty adversary. They call it the mighty one as well. That's why so many cultures put it in a high position as a god of some form. Not to be mixed up with the creator now. The creator that created this, paganism is one who is worshiping part of the creation and not the creator. Okay, that's the difference between paganism. And many of pagan gods were named after this planet. Zeus, it was talked about, Zeus could throw lightning bolts that would melt mountains. Well, we have part of a mountain melted in Africa over there. And it's called the Eye of the Sahara. And that is one massive crater. It's 30 miles across. It's flat. And it's proven that it's not part of a meteor crater. If I can find it.
Have you been waking a lot of people up? Have you noticed that over the past 6 months to a year, people are more accepting to this?
Yes, because no one else can. People are not. They just like the people of Nineveh. Jonah didn't create one miracle, but yet he was able to convince that whole town to just repent in a very serious way. Because they didn't have internet, they didn't have TV, they didn't have any of the distractions. They were in tune with nature. They saw bird kills, fish kills, seasonal change, crops dying, earthquakes probably, sinkholes, weird seasonal patterns, extreme cold, extreme hot. Okay? They knew something, things were out of whack. They saw animals acting strangely, you know? And then Jonah comes up and says, look, that object up there in the sky, he points to it. It says, in 40 days, your doom comes. Repent. And what God did is he changed it to where it passed to the left of Earth instead of to the right of Earth. Otherwise, it would cause a meteor shower that would have took out Nineveh. It passed to the left of Earth. Remember in Hezekiah?
Right.
It passed to the left. It causes a tilt. The Earth never stopped rotating. If it passed to the right, it will go through the plasma tail. If it passed to the left, plasma tail is pointing opposite of the sun. So the rotation of the Earth doesn't stop. But it passed close enough to cause us to tilt. And the tilt can happen on either side of it passing, depending on how close it comes. This next time, it's going to pass to the right of us, and it will cause us to tilt, and it will also cause us to slow down by 12 hours. We're having multiple combinations that's going to happen instead of just one or two of these. All the data in the Bible is pointing to us having multiples, a multiple combination of some very bad things. we would see 30 mile across lightning strikes like this one here, which is a lightning bolt between the planet, between that planet and us, which made that hit the Earth. And it dissolved almost 300 foot of a mountain and made this flat circular crater. And that's a 30 mile lightning bolt across. Now, when Earth is hit at that, it will reverse our north and south magnetic poles. When lightning hits a magnet, the magnetic fields reverse. So depending on how many times this planet will hit us with lightning or with the plasma, with a plasma bolt is the way I would put it, that would determine how many times our magnetic field would switch. And you can see what this, you see down here, Mars, right here?
Oh, yeah.
Can you see that little dot where I got my X? I'm going to move it. But right where that arrow is pointing,
yes.
There's a rock. There's a small rock in space that's called a comet. That little fragment caused this for Mars to light up. You see the way it did. That small comet did that amount of strike on the planet of Mars. What do you think of a rock that's seven times larger than Earth? What type of event is going to happen to Earth?
It's going to be catastrophic if it gets close and people don't prepare. I mean, certainly a lot's going to take place if this goes down.
You follow his instructions. He said on the Sabbath and the Jubilee. The Sabbath's already been finished. We're starting a Jubilee. He says, prepare 1 year food and supplies for that year, because that means that's so you don't have to stand in line at a food line or anything. And when it comes time, you'll see a peace agreement signed. Terrorism is going to stop, and they're going to force Israel to give up the West Bank. Well, they'll have 40 days to clear off 450,000 Jews off the West Bank. Well, you make your way to Jerusalem at that time. There'll be two prophets that show up on the Feast of Passover. 3.5 days later is when Yeshua is going to show up. That will be exactly the time when this planet is crossing Earth's path. When the other side of Earth is getting hit by meteor showers, and the side that he's on, which is the nighttime side, they were told by astronomers they were going to be hit. So the majority of the people are underground. Only his people.
With sky cams and stuff, just on their time off, basically, and they see these planets that have came in that they haven't seen before, that have been there now for just about a year. So when we talked before the show, you think that none of this stuff is really able to be accessible via view because it's being blocked or cloaked somehow with the government, correct?
Correct. They have the capabilities with lasers to cloak an object. They're like 30 years ahead of the public on where to take. Technology is, we can, I have a video on my YouTube chart, I think it's called Bonus 2, that shows at the end of it, it shows at present what their what laboratories are doing. Well, the government's about 30 years ahead of that, and they can cloak an object.
So they're cloaking these objects with lasers and stuff, but maybe there's certain times that technology isn't working good enough, so somebody's able to get a shot in and possibly pick something up. Do you think it's in our solar system right now?
Yes, without a doubt. Kepler's laws of planetary motion, and with our present knowledge of the model that the Chinese astronomers and the Korean and the Japanese astronomers gave us, it would take 16 years to reach the Earth if it was at the orbit of Neptune. It would take 16 years to reach us. So for it to arrive, I say, with the present effects that the Earth is having, I would say that it's no more than 5 years away, probably less than two. You know, it may even show up this next, we need to pay attention each March and April that's coming up. And because that's its exit point. And this time, the biblical record says that it's going to be the worst time in all of Earth history. So that, since it only passed close to Earth four times in its past, the scriptural accounts is alluding to a very close passing of it again. So we should see it. Maybe I would think that they'd let us see it anywhere from 30 to 90 days out, but the internet will be down. People probably won't be texting each other or sending pictures. They have to have control over the people. And one of the ways they're going to do it, when you see a bail-in or a rationing of money, which is what a bail-in is, then they'll ration food and then they'll ration fuel. If you got those three rationed, you have the control over the masses. And so they're much easier to deal with because they're basically dependent upon the government to give them food. And that's where they'll start volunteering people with the chip system, as the Bible talks about. And some people choose to use a credit card type chip. But the best way to handle that is to listen to the Bible. It says on a Sabbath and a Jubilee to store up 1 year of food and basically supplies. Therefore, you won't have to be bothered by standing in line during terrorism and probably diseases of different types and not have to deal with that type of ordeal that's fixing to come up.
So you think that if you take the chip, you're just going to be given a fresh pass, basically like a golden ticket, and you can get through and food, access to other things, essentially, as long as you follow the playbook?
Exactly. Basically, you're going to have a certain amount of rations per month according to the card. And so you can't buy over that. That's how they're going to, you know, limit who gets what type of food. Even though you have cash, well, they won't allow it, probably, because because they're not going to have enough food. When the bail-in happens, and shortly after that, maybe 3 or 4 months later, the economy crashes, farmers can't get a loan to put seed in the ground. Manufacturers may be laying off that are doing the canning and preparation of meats and vegetables. You'd have a breakdown in the economy where the government would have to force people to go to work. And they have this all written out. They have a game, like a game book of FEMA that they plan on following. And
I remember, I was just going to, I didn't mean to interrupt there, Gil. I was just going to jump in because when I was like 14, so this would have been over 20 years ago, I was warned about how eventually when the government does clamp down to a one-world system, the person that was telling me this, his mom was high into the FBI. She had some very, you know, prestigious positions with the Department of Defense, etc. And he was talking about the microchip and the roundups and the FEMA camps and how it was going to be Chinese and Soviets, etc. People not from this country, or UN troops, actually, what he called blue hats, that were going to round people up. But there wasn't a lot of talk about Nibiru or Planet X at the time. It was more just about the one-world government. What I'm wondering is if this Planet X is going to cause just catastrophic events and the Georgia Guidestones with the 500 million mark people, etc. Maybe that's all connected there. And in order to usher that up, that's why they're going to use the UN troops and everything else, because they knew about this specific cataclysm years ago. Is that a possibility?
I don't know if they knew about it at that time. For sure, they knew about it around 92, maybe even earlier. But they had confirmation by the Pioneer and Voyager probes. If you turn on astronomy software and turn on where they went, and if you have the overlay of the Chinese on what their data shows, you can see how they triangulated the position of this object, and it's coming out of the constellation Sagittarius, that is actually south of the universe, and so they've been known about it since at least 1992. They had confirmation of it, and they've been preparing ever since. Now, I think we're within a couple years, maybe this next year. Don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't tell the future. I'm just saying that the signs that we're seeing on Earth tells me that this item has to be close. We're seeing the orbit of the moon on Saturn warped. We're seeing the orbit of our own moon stretched. You know, it's called perpendations. That can only happen if you have an object that's fairly close. And put it this way, let's say if it's, someone would say it's 16 years away. Well, if we have the effects of what we're seeing right now and it's 16 years away, I would hate to see it when it gets close, because it would be so severe that it doesn't have to pass close to us. But according to the past records, you can look in the biblical records as well as other places, you're going to see what's common is a 7-year drought, 7 years or longer. And you see that there's a, when it's mentioning a double eclipse, that can't happen in a natural. That takes a third object to give you two eclipses in the same time period. Because The moon is what causes that causes a solar eclipse, and then the sun and earth is what causes the moon to have an eclipse. You can't have them both at the same time. It's automatically describing they have to have a larger object that give you 3 hours of darkness, because the moon can only give you 7.3 minutes of darkness before the earth will roll out of the shadow, and it only covers only just a handful of countries. The outside secular records, as well as the biblical records, said the entire earth was darkened for 3 hours. The moon can't do that. That's geometrically, it's impossible. The math does not work out. You can't build a model on that. And it just, remember what science is pertaining to astronomy. If you can take this observed phenomena, bring it into laboratory and show that it's repeatable, that's science. And we have not just proving out the Chinese models, but we've proved out 14 incidents in the biblical records and five secular where we believe that it's past. And there's mathematical evidence and as well as a sequence of events that people didn't have the knowledge of to fake. They didn't have the physics down. They didn't know that it could do this that level of events in that particular sequence of patterns. It's impossible for them to fake this. That's why when you find something that's fake, you can usually find an error in it, either in the science, the math, or something. When we use the proper science, which is the physics model, instead of the astronomy model, we're getting something that works out. That's running an exact match. And that gives us great concern, because this object crosses Earth's path twice, not once, twice. And it has roughly 150 to 152 day and separation between entry and exit. And the biblical records, which is a future event in Revelation, gives astounding information when you know how to process it on this next event. And
have you been able to figure out how many days and nights it's going to be total on the round trip?
You mean
so if we were to take both, you know, coming past us, you said it's going to come past us twice with the orbit. How many days total would that be where it would cause?
Hold on. Okay. Yeah, yeah. The planet doesn't pass by us twice. Okay. It crosses Earth's orbit twice. It's only by Earth one time. And that's in March, April event. The next, now, it's on its way out. It's going out into deep space. 152 days later, Earth runs into the debris field of the second, you know, wherever it came in at. That, the, you see, debris field that this thing going to leave behind will carry on for many years after. We will have sporadic meteor showers when we cross those two points again, multiple times in the future. But the most severe is the first two times that we cross. That's where the, you see, debris is either the largest or the most concentrated. Later on in years later, it gets lesser and smaller object, we hope. It's just something that you can't exactly predict 100% on. And so it only passes near Earth once. Now it should be in the month of March or April. Roughly 3.5 days after Passover, according to the biblical records on what we can tell what's going to happen here.
Is it going to cause, you know, some serious earth displacement, and are we going to see sinkholes and such, very similar to the movie 2012?
Sinkholes would be the minor of your problems.
Okay, right. I'm sure you're right. What about, let me ask you this, Gil, what about being on a big boat or something in the middle of the ocean or off the sound, Puget Sound somewhere, so when everything hits the fan, you've got an opportunity to kind of just, I mean, what, or a submarine or something?
Look, there's huge currents underneath the ocean as well. Just because the waves are whirling on the top doesn't mean you're not bouncing up and down on the bottom. That's a false. You can talk to any submariner. He'll tell you that. It's also sometimes a rough ride underneath, especially when you go in those thermal planes. It really gets to be a wild ride. You'd have less wave action, like in the middle of the Pacific, opposite of Jerusalem area, That's probably where the least waves would be. But I wouldn't risk it. I would choose something like either the Persian Gulf or the Mediterranean would have a better chance of basically surviving if you're in the middle of it, not at the shoreline. Because even those we will have a sloshing effect in the Mediterranean, because the Bible even says names three major towns on the Israeli coast, as well as the Nile area being wiped out. So you're going to have some tidal problems in the Mediterranean, but it won't be as severe as the oceans. The oceans, you're looking at waves that we've never seen normally. Every so often when a large ship hits what's called a freak wave, sometimes they'll snap the ship in half because the gaps between the waves and the height of it causes too much stress in the middle of the hull. And the steel structure can't handle multiple hits like that. So even your larger ships will snap in half. The Bible talks about one third of all the ships being destroyed. Talks about one third of all of the trees and grass, and even the rivers and all of your fresh water above ground is going to be toxic. When meteors are made of material that can render fresh water not drinkable, at least for a month or two, until it settles out. And not counting the problems that we will have with all of the nuclear facilities not having fuel or their cooling water or their water in their rivers evacuate. Therefore, they don't. It only takes a few hours before a meltdown will start and be completely melted down within 8 to 12 hours later. It doesn't take long. And then after that, it'll make hydrogen, and then the top would blow off, just like it did in Fukushima. Right. We're looking at and that ain't counting all of the majority of the volcanoes going off. That's not counting that when the half of the Earth that's facing the plasma of this comet tail, that's like a constant EMP wave hitting that side of the Earth. Chances of any electronics working after that are slim to none. So you're looking at no possible way of drawing water out of the ground unless it's manual. And that's, chances are your water wells that you dug, the pipes that you use to dig the well will be sheared.